members. We have a quorum, and this is the appointed time. Let's start today's meeting. Members, please note that since the last meeting, the Secretariat has issued one information paper, CB(1128/2024)01, which is a letter from Mr. Ambrose Lam dated the 5th of August 2024 relating to the questionnaire survey on co-parenting. Next items for discussion at the next meetings. Would members please refer to CB(11311/2024)01 as well as (02). And also would members please note that the Social Worker Registration Amendment Ordinance 2024 was gazetted on the 5th of July 2024. We are going to delete item 9 on the list of items for discussion, and that is role, reform and development of the Social Workers Registration Board. So we're no longer discussing this item. As for the next meeting, the next regular meeting will be held at 10:45 on the 11th of November 2024. Let's see if members agree with the two items proposed by the administration. First, briefing on the Chief Executive's 2024 policy address, as well as the second item, annual adjustments to the social security payment rates under the CSSA scheme and social security allowance scheme, and issues relating to employment support services under the CSSA scheme. Any views? Right. Let's move on to the agenda proper. Would members please refer to LC paper CB(11311/2024)03 and 04. This is an item on promotion and application of gerontechnology. I will invite Mr. Ho Kai-ming, Undersecretary for Labour and Welfare, to walk us through the paper. Members, if you have questions, you may press the request to speak button now. Over to you, Undersecretary. Thank you. Chairman, members, today we brief members on promotion and application of gerontechnology. The government has been encouraging society to make better use of gerontechnology and enhancing digital training for elderly so as to improve the quality of life and relieve the burden of their carers. Through Innovation Technology Fund for Application in Elderly in Rehab Care, or INT Fund, we subsidize the use of gerontech products. At the moment, the scheme benefits about 20 service units. $750 million have so far been granted as at the August of 2024, subsidizing about 2,000 service units to procure or rent 21,000 tech products. And the chief executive announced in the 2023 policy address that an additional injection of $1 billion will be made into the fund, and will also explore raising the maximum amount of grant available and allowing extra funding for NGOs to apply for additional funding to procure tech products suitable for household use, for lending by elderly and PWDs and their carers for use at home on top of the maximum amount of grants. We are formulating implementation details. They will be launched in the first quarter of 2025. In order for the welfare sector to understand the latest gerontech development, we set up a platform for the sector to showcase gerontech products and application solutions for adoption by the sector. We also further subsidize the use of tech products by frail elderly persons. Starting from September 2023, we expanded the coverage of community care service voucher for the elderly to the rental of assistive tech products such as walking aids, mobility transfer, and aids for bathing or toileting. For digital inclusion, we have the information and communications tech ICT outreach programs for the elderly. We also have the enriched ICT training program for the elderly, as well as an online platform, elderly IT learning portal, to facilitate learning of technology by elderly. In the budget 2024-25, we have allocated $100 million to promote digital inclusion program for the elderly, and community-based help desk will be set up. The fifth point is that the Social Welfare Department has expanded the service scope of over 210 subvented district elderly community centers and elderly centers in the neighborhood to promote the use of gerontech since October 2023. We will do more to encourage the sector to make better use of gerontech products. Thank you. 10 members are waiting in line. Let me read out the names. Mr. Tang Yuanhen, Mr. Michael Tan, Dr. Te Chi Yun, Mr. Chen Pui Leung, Ms. Lam So Wai, Mr. Stanley Lee, Mr. Nam Chen Sing, Mr. Ring Kong, Mr. Stanley Ng, and Ms. Judy Chan. Each will have 4 minutes questions and answer. Thank you, Chair. Now, I visited the gerontechnology exhibition held by Red Cross last time. I'd say that we've made progress in terms of using gerontechnology. Now, my question is this. The INT Fund has provided subsidies to eligible organizations to rent gerontech or assistive products for use by elderly. However, I'd like to know the feedback from users. And we also have a lot of important questions to help the developers improve their products. All these are very important indicators of assessment. So at the time of applying for subsidies, would the government consider imposing conditions instead of conducting inspections afterwards? For example, on a regular basis, those applying for the subsidy or grant may submit reports to you on how these products are used. So with reports at hand, you'll be able to have a clear idea of user feedback. This will also help monitoring of the efficient use of the INT fund. The next question is this. There are constraints relating to each and every care home. There may be difference in terms of the capability of care workers. As a result, some gerontechnology products may be put on the shelf and left idle for a long time. They are not put to good use. So will the government follow up on these cases? And for those unused equipment and products, could you ask the organizations to return them to you for lending to other needy users? Two questions. Undersecretary, thank you, Chair. I thank Dr. Tan Yuanhen for appreciating the INT Fund's effectiveness. I'll give the floor to my colleague, and my colleague will say more about collecting user feedback and forwarding the feedback to the developer of these products. And for the idle products, how we encourage reuse, I'll give that to my colleague as well. As part of the INT Fund mechanism, we regularly monitor the use of gerontech products. We also conduct questionnaire surveys to gauge user feedback. 70 to 80% of users agree that these tech products could help enhance the efficiency of frontline personnel, as well as promoting occupational health and safety of care workers. We will review the use of the INT fund in general. For example, after they've procured the products and used them for some time, it may be possible for these products to be used by another organization. But this is something that we are exploring so that more organizations will be able to benefit from the fund. Any follow-up question? members. I'm sorry to say that there is a glitch in our system. So please, if you want to ask questions, press the button again so that we know you want to speak. Yes, let me read out the names, yes. I think you already read out the list. Can we follow that order? Can we speak in that order? You don't need to rely on the computer because we already formed the queue just now. But we didn't jot down the names. Madam Clerk does not have the list. But you don't need to rely on the computer because we have memorized our positions. The next one should be Mr. Michael Tian, and then I'll be the next one to speak. Right, who's the next to speak, please, Mr. Michael Tian? This shows how technology works. I think, well, this is a deliberate glitch because we're talking about gerontechnology. Next is Mr. Michael Tian. Chair, I'm looking at paragraphs 10 and 11. The government has walked us through the initiatives in familiarizing our elderly with digital technology and the relevant gerontech products. This is something that we have been advocating for years. Let's assume that with a mobile phone in hand, you'll be able to book tickets for high-speed rail and do so many things. You don't need a desktop computer. Apart from driving social development, technology also brings a dark side of its development, and that is online scams. For example, sometimes I receive WhatsApp messages, I'm told not to click the links. In the first half of 2024, there were 20,000 online scams, 60%, I mean scams, and 60% were online scams. Some of them related to fraudulent claims of payments to online platforms, and that 1,600 cases were recorded. And in July alone, we recorded 1,100 such cases. It is very important that we taught elderly how to differentiate fraudsters. I don't see anything in the paper about educating elderly people about scams. So can you tell me whether you think teaching elderly to use technology would be sufficient, or have you been doing anything to combat fraud? Because Undersecretary, I think apart from educating elderly, you also need to help them prevent being falling victims of scams. Well, gerontechnology is a broad term. It covers not only mobile phones, but also other aspects in software and hardware. Online scams are prevalent. I know that the police and other government departments have been joining hands in teaching members of the public and the elderly not to fall victim to such crime. For example, if you receive an incoming call, you should make sure that there is a hash in front, a hash sign in front of the prefix, or else it could be a fraudulent call. There are also other problems relating to online scams. I don't think this is covered by gerontechnology, but we will relay your concern to the police in a timely manner. Right, but I still think this is a problem. You are educating elderly people about gerontechnology. Say, as an elderly person, I'm quite ignorant, and then I need somebody to tell me about scams, bank frauds. I really think you should tell the elderly the 101 of digital technology. It's absurd not to mention these things in your training programs. You should not rely on another channel to educate them. It would be problematic otherwise.
Under Secretary, at district elderly centers and neighborhood elderly centers, we work closely with the police. Some social welfare service units, when they get information from the police, they deal with frauds as well. Well, it's crucial that your courses cover online frauds. Well, we have retrieved the original order of members in our system, so don't worry about remembering your order. Dr. Tae Chi Yun, gerontechnology is the way to go. We have to make use of technologies to deal with problems in relation to resources and manpower. I'm glad that $1 billion are going to be injected into the relevant fund. As Undersecretary mentioned, we have spent about $750 million by 2,200 service units covering over 20 products and projects. I'm worried that the government is only spending money to tackle the problems. We have been to the mainland to observe the different elderly care services. There are different equipment and gears that support elderly. For instance, there are devices that monitor whether elderly people would fall or whether they take medication regularly. There are over 100 elderly people in one care home that were taken care of by technology products. The government spent $750 million over the past decade, and I'm not seeing significant results. My question is simple. Undersecretary, can you tell me that there are 5 projects that are effective and are widely adopted and sustainable over the past 10 years? Please give 5 examples, Undersecretary. I think there are different types of technology products used in different areas. For instance, in some care homes for the disabled, there are some devices that help children with disabilities to walk. This is one example of how we make use of gerontechnology. In some elderly care homes, for instance, 9 CMS systems are used to help dispense medication and drugs in care homes that are displayed in one exhibition. Only one TV screen is required for such technology. You don't need a very big screen. Perhaps Dr. Tick is not aware of these devices, but these devices have been widely adopted in different occasions. You can point out these projects, but can you tell us whether there are projects that are widely adopted and sustainable as well as effective? There are different projects displayed in exhibitions, but these projects aren't sustainable. You mentioned about drug dispensing. A few days ago, there were news reports saying that there are numerous problems with drug dispensing in elderly care homes. Can you tell us that the projects that you funded can effectively help elderly people in Hong Kong? I'm saying whether the projects are effective, widely adopted, and sustainable. Assistant Director, some of the commonly used technology products include devices that can measure vital signs of elderly people. There are also devices and projectors that help with the cognitive training of elderly people. There are also bed exit sensors. there are also tools used for occupational therapy. Chairman, I'm not happy with the administration's answers. Can there be supplementary submissions from the government telling us what projects have been effective? Mr. Chen Puileng. Thank you, Chairman. I support the idea of putting in resources to promote gerontechnology. As Dr. Tek Chi Yun said, I'm concerned about the effectiveness of the money spent. According to the paper, there is an SIE fund which creates a gerontechnology platform. This platform began in April this year. It's been only half a year now. I see that the platform links up stakeholders from the supply and demand sides to see if there are any collaborative opportunities between the supply and demand sides to promote gerontechnology. It is common that there are platforms that offer certain services in the preliminary stage. However, how can we ensure that these platforms can ensure effective matching services? This platform is currently run by an NGO, a third party. Are there any indicators or targets set for the NGO, that is the operator of the platform, to ensure that they can generate results within a certain period of time? Otherwise, you'll just be spending a lot of money and not ensuring effective matching services. I'd like to know if you have a target on how long the gerontechnology platform will run for. Are there clear KPIs for the platform so that it can meet your service target? Undersecretary, this platform is a collaborative platform between the ITIB as well as the HKCSS, the Hong Kong Council of Social Service. We will supply further information about this platform after the meeting. Ms. Connie Lam. Thank you, Chairman. In terms of promoting and applying gerontechnology, I think it is inevitable that we have to inject resources. From 2018 to now, it's been 6 years, and $750 million have been injected by the government, subsidizing 2,000 service units to procure or rent over 21,000 technology products. Each product costs about $35,700. How many of these products are rented or procured? Are the prices reasonable? Over the past 6 years, each service unit on average procure or rent 10 products. That is less than 5 products per year. Does that meet your target? Well, gerontechnology is going to be a major trend, but every year only 1 to 2 technology products are procured or rent by these service units. For the INT fund, since it's been established, I mean since the establishment of the gerontechnology platform in April, have there been any progresses made? Are there any statistics or figures that you can share with us in terms of its effectiveness? Lastly, on the voucher scheme, it's been a year since the launch of the Community Care Service Voucher Scheme. Elderly people can use the vouchers to rent products. Since August, only 500 users have been using this scheme. For caregivers and elderly people, this scheme should be beneficial because they can make use of voucher schemes to rent or procure, for instance, geriatric chairs. However, how come there have only been 500 users? Can you tell us why? Is it because there is lack of publicity? Undersecretary, I'll say a few words and I'll defer to Assistant Director to tell you more. There's difference in terms of the development of drone technology in Hong Kong and mainland. Like Dr. Tek Chee Yun said, in the mainland, there has been wide adoption of drone technology in the community level, not in residential care homes. In Hong Kong, however, the first $1 billion were for subvented care homes, mainly. So the $1 billion are for elderly people who have passed the standardized care need assessment mechanism. Going back to what Ms. Connie Lam asked, the products that we were referring to are quite expensive and they are medical related, so the cost for each product is high. It is not so much adopted at the community level, but at residential care homes. To respond to Ms. Lam's question about how many of these products were procured and how many were rented, for elderly care and rehabilitation service units, they account for 90% of the service units that procure or rented these products, because on a day-to-day basis, they have to use these products to support their elderly residents or elderly users. On the use of community care service vouchers, as at September this year, there have been over 10,000 users under the CCSV scheme. How come only 5,000 users rented or procured technology products under the scheme? Let me explain to you. Upon assessment, each service unit who passed the assessment would come up with a personal care scheme or plan with the elderly user. This covers what kind of technology products have to be used by the user. There are physiotherapists and occupational therapists that help make assessments as well. After assessment, the elderly users may procure or rent certain technology products. A lot of the users, after renting technology products, may end up procuring the products. So it's hard to give you a breakdown in terms of how many users actually procure or rent these technology products. However, we will continue to step up publicity so that more people or suppliers can offer these products. We have over 200 product suppliers, and they provide a lot of rental services of sharing technology products. It should be 500 users instead of 5,000 users. Is that right? So 500 is a small number. You have 10,000 quotas for the voucher scheme, but only 500 users under the scheme. I think you should let elderly people or caregivers know about this voucher scheme and the rental services available. Mr. Stanley Lee, I support the government in putting in resources to promote drone technology. The government has been promoting drone technology for a long time. Some members are concerned about whether drone technology is widely applied. Has the government learned about the feedback of elderly users or elderly people in general? Elderly people might fear digital technology because they're worried that it is troublesome or that they do not know how to use these technologies. They're also worried about network problems. My question is this. The government has been using public funds to promote drone technology. How can the government help elderly people effectively? Without support, elderly people would not want to use drone technology. Instead, they would go back to traditional methods. As far as I understand, Wi-Fi is necessary. to use some of these gerontechnology products. For those who do not have Wi-Fi at home, they won't be able to use these products. How can you ensure that elderly people can be familiar with using these gerontechnology products and provide feedback for these product suppliers? You have this outreach program for elderly people. However, is the outreach program effective?
My second question is this. Other members talked about procuring or renting such products, but I don't think this is a common phenomenon. Now, for a feeding device, this is something that elderly people use every day. It's very expensive if you want to buy one, but do we have sufficient stock for rent? This is the nitty-gritty you need to consider. You need to make sure that the practical needs of elderly can be met so that they will not shun digital technology. Because I'm not an elderly, but I also shun technology. I've just bought a new TV. I don't know how to set it up. I called the hotline and asked. Nowadays, the configurations could become very complicated. If not even I could solve this problem, how do we expect elderly people to do the same? Under Secretary, 2 years ago on the A-plus platform, I mean, under this panel, we have the subcommittee on gerontechnology. We visited this center, which is the Age at Home Jockey Club Center. We also provide the feeding device, which can be rented before you buy one. So we make available gerontech products. We have two ends of the spectrum. We have elderly people requiring intensive care, and we also have the younger olds who need to be educated about not so much during technology, but on other forms of digital technology, such as mobile phones. So this is an item on gerontechnology and providing care for the elderly. Meanwhile, we also have outreach programs teaching elderly people about the use of mobile technology and digital technology. So these are the two different fronts. Right, so Under Secretary, I know that there are two different things. Now, for elderly people requiring high level of care, we're talking about the really senior citizens, and they have different needs. They may be in their 80s and 90s requiring high level of care, and the carers themselves may be in their 50s, 60s. So likewise, they may have some sort of phobia towards digital technology. Next, Mr. Lam San-keung. Apart from supporting residential care homes, the INT fund should also take care of elderly people who are aging in place. Because by not going to a residential care home, they are releasing more quotas for the needy elderly. But at the same time, you need to take care of their needs in the community. Say, out of the $1 billion injection, you should set aside $200 or $300 million for gerontech products to be used in the community. For procuring technologies that are commonly used. For example, a week ago, I visited some elderly people living in subdivided units. There was this elderly person in his 70s who has mobility issues, and the bed is just right next to the toilet. This elderly needs to go to toilet quite often. So perhaps we can help him procure gerontech products that can help him go to toilet or shower on his own. We can avoid having him admitted to a residential care home and make him stay in a community and age in place for longer. So apart from tackling subdivided units, you should also allocate more resources to help these elderly people to age in place. And to pick up on Ms. Connie Lam's point about using the community care service voucher for the elderly, now this scheme was just rolled out in August this year. That may account for the relatively small number of users, and that's 500 according to her. I also think it may have to do with not having sufficient tech products available apart from those in the annex, such as a feeding device, anti-wandering system, anti-fall devices, etc. They should be included in the list of gerontech products as well. In order to catch up with the latest technology, you should review this reference list more frequently so that more elderly people can make use of the CCSV to buy gerontech products. I thank Mr. Lam for the questions, first on using gerontechnology and the second about the living conditions. There may be a need for a mobile toilet or handrails. Gerontechnology presents a good solution, and it is also our objective to adhere to the wish of the elderly whether to live in a home or not. It also depends on the size of the elderly's home whether gerontech products can be put to use. Now, I'm interested in the case just mentioned by Mr. Lam. If need be, we can pay a visit and see whether the elderly tenant can be relocated to, say, a transitional housing unit. Say, if he lives in a subdivided unit, it may not even be possible to install temporary handrails. So something else needs to be done. Assistant Director Leung can supplement. Thank you, Mr. Lam, for the comments. There are 12 items covered by the CCSV scheme for the elderly to rent assistive tech products. And these are products needed by elderly in the community in general. But we can review this list. We keep all options open. We conduct regular reviews. As I explained, we devise a personal care plan for each elderly person. We look at the items needed by this elderly to stay in the community, and we also see the check the available products for procurement or for rent. And sometimes the schemes may provide products that are already that are on a trial. But we do allow procurement and rental of the products. Ms. Doreen Kong. Thank you, Chair. I support the use of gerontechnology. I have a number of questions. Are the accounts audited after disbursing funds? I think this is a matter close to the heart of members. I want to know more about auditing. In other words, after approving grants, do you conduct regular inspection, checks, or audits, whatever, as to what has been procured? Is there a mechanism? Another question. According to the administration, they keep in check the elderly service units. Can you tell us the products procured after dishing out $750 million? The third question is this. I know that some of these products involve machines. Is there wear and tear? Have you taken that into account as well? The fourth question is this. When it comes to gerontechnology, mobile phones are essential. These phones carry certain functions. Are statistics available? And that is to say, how many in our elderly population age 65 or above have mobile phones? I'll give the floor to Assistant Director. About the INT fund for application in elderly and rehab care, I will tell you about the checks and balances. We have a panel that vets applications. At the same time, our colleagues also regularly review the use of grants. We conduct questionnaire surveys. We also make visits to see how these products are used by the service units. At the same time, we talk to the staff as well as the users to see if they benefit from the products. And we also like to find out whether they encounter any difficulties. After being granted a sum under this INT fund, the service unit will be required to return a questionnaire to us. The questionnaire includes questions about whether the tech product is useful, as well as the feedback from users and their family members. There is also a question on whether the tech products could help relieve work stress among staff members. Apart from visits and questionnaire surveys, the service units are also required to comply with record keeping requirements. And that is, after procuring the tech products, these products should be used in and within the service units. We conduct regular checks. On the issue of wear and tear, despite putting in place this fund for some time, we have yet to set up a mechanism to check the wear and tear aspects of the of any particular machine. But we will keep in view the situation. She hasn't answered the question on mobile phones, Chair. Yes, about mobile phone coverage. We don't have this information at hand. We can give you this information after the meeting, Chair. Next, Mr. Stanley. Chairman, I support this topic along with other members. We agree that more should be done to promote gerontechnology. More importantly, we want to gauge its effectiveness. We use technology in order to benefit the users, and that's the elderly, as well as their carers or staff. We want to enhance work efficiency for them. And that means objective assessment. As legislative members, we sometimes visit care homes, and in our capacity, we're often given a very optimistic picture of the operation. But more importantly, we need to find out about the feelings of the care workers, as well as their family members, as well as the frail elderly who can't live independently. I want to make sure that there is an objective assessment for the money put in. technology helps save manpower. What is the government's assessment in this regard? Can the government tell us by investing how much in technology we are able to save manpower by how much, for example, because it may well be the case that despite using technology, we are not saving manpower and then we need to import labor further.
Undersecretary. Mr. M's question is valid. We do have to assess the effectiveness of the money we put in. Last year, we passed a bill and on imposing high standards on residential care homes, and we will continue to enhance the service level of residential care homes. Hong Kong is ranked one of the top among the world in terms of our life expectancy. Technology products are helping elderly people who are taken care of by elderly. I'll ask Assistant Director to tell you more about this. In terms of promoting gerontechnology, we hope that through making use of technology, we can improve elderly people's quality of life. At the same time, we hope staff members from residential care homes can feel less stressed. By introducing gerontechnology, we should be able to attract more local workers to join the industry, because by using technology, we can improve their work environment. According to the law, there is a certain number of staff members residential care homes should hire. For subvented care homes, we also have a standard in terms of manpower. We want to, through the use of technology, improve the service quality of these care homes. At the same time, we want to relieve the burden of staff members of these care homes. Ms. Judy Chen. I support the allocation of resources to promoting gerontechnology. People in Hong Kong are getting more and more used to the use of technology to improve their quality of life. According to the paper, the reference list of recognized technology application products is updated from time to time. I looked at the reference list myself. For nursing beds, for instance, the cheapest one might cost $7,000, and the most expensive one may cost as high as $70,000. We see a huge price difference. For instance, for a multifunctional wheelchair, the cheapest one is $5,000. The most expensive one is $100,000. Say I'm a user and I have to make a choice. There are many choices for me. For a robot that serves disinfection function, the price can range from $40,000 to $300,000. Again, we see a huge price difference. When users are making a choice, how much support or assistance are they given? When the administration includes products into the reference list, is there a screening mechanism? Is there a certain threshold that you impose, for instance, for products manufactured in the mainland or those invented locally would be given priority to be included in the list? Assistant Director. Ms. Chen is right. Under the INT Fund, there is a reference list of recognized technology application products for applicants to look at. There are different types of products in the list. For some products, they are manufactured in different places. They may serve different functions, and that's why we see a huge price difference. The price may range from $7,000 to $70,000. We'll look at how we can optimize the reference list. For instance, we may have to state specifically what kind of functions a product that costs $7,000 can serve for easier reference by applicants or service units. Can we prioritize products manufactured on the mainland and those invented in Hong Kong to be put into the list? Administration, anything to add? Well, comments noted. We'll look into it. Mr. Kenneth Lung. I'd like to follow up on the question posed by Ms. Judy Chen just now. Are there any policies that encourage local INT enterprises to develop gerontech products? I ask this question because we all know that there is limited space in Hong Kong compared to other cities or countries in the world. Are there policies that encourage local INT enterprises to develop technology products to improve people's life or living environment? I see that the government has been rolling out different types of programs for elderly people. Are you only teaching elderly people to, for instance, use mobile phones? Is it a one-off program or one-off course? We young people may find it difficult to use certain apps sometimes, not to mention elderly people. How can we ensure that elderly people can be more tech-savvy? In terms of applying gerontechnology, how frequently is the government working with healthcare institutions? Can the government take the initiative to encourage elderly people who are discharged from hospitals to make use of gerontech products? Can you work with healthcare or medical institutions to promote the use of gerontech products? Undersecretary. Through the INT Fund, we subsidize users in making use gerontech products. For those who are interested in developing gerontech products, there is an Other Seat Fund, which is also a form of INT Fund under the ITIB. The gerontech products that we are referring to in our paper are those that are more mature and those that are included in the reference list because they have been trialed by different users and organizations. Assistant Director. the INT fund that we are referring to here is not for research and development by INT enterprises. However, we can partner with INT enterprises to see if they can help develop gerontech products to help with rehabilitation. For example, there are sleeping management platforms or smart bed systems that can be trialed by different users. These users may give feedback to INT enterprises, and these INT enterprises can then develop products that can accommodate the needs of elderly people and persons with disabilities. For elderly patients who are discharged from hospitals, our social workers would work with hospitals and relevant units and refer the discharged patients to make use of gerontech products. How about the point about digital inclusion? We don't have the information at hand now. We'll provide the relevant information after the meeting. Dr. David Lam. For those who have been to gerontech exhibitions or expo, you would be amazed by how many types of gerontech products are available nowadays. However, elderly people or potential users or even professionals may find it hard to choose what kind of products they should use. For elderly people who need to rent technology products, the reality is that there aren't many products that they may come across. My question is therefore whether it is possible for you to develop a centralized platform for rental services. Say a staff member may notice that an elderly resident of the care home may need a certain technology product, but such product is not available at the care home or at the service unit, and they may go to the centralized platform for such product. There are devices that monitor the vital signs of elderly persons. Are these data shared with the government, or are these data shared with the health e-health platform? It would be very time consuming if doctors have to copy this data from scratch when they see elderly patients. Can you ensure data sharing between the e-health platform and these and organizations making use of these devices? Can district healthcare centers provide rental services of gerontech products as well? Undersecretary, as far as I understand, district health centers currently do not provide such services. However, we ask district elderly community centers or neighborhood elderly centers to help promote gerontech products. As for the point about data sharing, it is a great idea that this data should be shared with the e-health platform. However, it is hard for us to gain access to the hospital authority system, so we have to look into it.
Ms.
Lam, Dr. Lam mentioned too many choices available, and this is often the complaint that we receive because the service units may attend the fair, an exhibition, and find it hard to decide which product to procure. We encourage information sharing. Users can share the experience with other service units. I also agree with your suggestion that products should be allowed to be leased to another organization. We'll go back and see how this can be done. I'd like to follow up on a number of questions already raised by members. Well, we attend many exhibitions. In fact, I go every year, and we are quite astonished by the latest technology. Many of the technologies showcased are very advanced. For example, the Japanese technology is really amazing, but this is not commercially available in Hong Kong because they haven't tapped our market. And we are relying too much on the ITC. I don't know how much time the Commission has for gerontechnology. I don't think I should point fingers at your bureau because, after all, you are not tech professionals. But gerontechnology is going to be a very important aspect of elderly care. You need to work better with the ITI Bureau because they may take the lead in inviting R&D organizations to carry out activities in Hong Kong. And I don't think you can answer my question now. I think it is important. You should translate words into action. Gerontechnology covers a really broad scope, and the back-end operation is equally important, as mentioned by a number of members. We need to process data effectively at the back office. There should be a sharing of data to enhance efficiency. Apparently, in the mainland, they use a very different system and they have very different laws and regulations. I think those who went on visits before would know. I'd like to give you the example in the mainland. Likewise, the technologies used in the mainland are really amazing. Yet, they are not commercially available in Hong Kong because they cannot meet the EMSD's requirement, or they have no intention of tapping our market. So I think you need to work with the EMSD as well to make sure that the technology can be made available in Hong Kong. Now, I understand it is your objective to allow organizations more say on the matter, but I don't know whether this is the best approach. For larger organizations, they may be well endowed with resources. They may be able to conduct preliminary research for us. Because otherwise, the market is quite fragmented. Frankly, sharing technology covers a very broad scope. The government should take the lead in collaborating with major organizations and universities. Say, if you want to go smart, you need to first identify what products to cover. The electric bed, and the devices you mentioned, I don't think they involve smart technology. So we need to better deploy smart technology to help provide better care. Chairman, I fully agree with you. In the welfare sector in Hong Kong, we have a lot of small and medium-sized social welfare organizations. They are subvented or subsidized by the government. It is very important that they adopt a technology more extensively. This can help enhance their operation, and that is why we provide grants for them to adopt the technologies. At the same time, we also encourage visits to neighboring places such as Shenzhen or other cities in the mainland. They should go to these exhibitions. Last time I visited this exhibition, and in fact, after going to this exhibition, a service unit has decided to, or in fact has procured the same machine, and they are mounting publicity at the moment. So they should keep themselves up to date on the latest technology available. That means we should consider technologies available in the mainland and other places. Let's turn to the next item now. Members, please refer to paper number CB bracket 11311/2024/05 and 06. This is an item on drug management of residential care homes for the elderly. Undersecretary will walk us through the paper in a moment. Members, if you want to ask questions, please press the request to speak button now. Undersecretary, you take the floor, please. Thank you, Chair. Chairman, members, today we brief members on the drug management of residential care homes for the elderly. With an aging population, there's been an increased demand for residential care home services. There are reasons that elderly people stay in homes for health and other reasons. We've done our utmost to enhance the quality of 800 care homes in Hong Kong to ensure the well-being of elderly residents. Now, the Residential Care Home Legislation Miscellaneous Amendments Ordinance 2023 was gazetted in June last year, which imposes a number of requirements such as proper storage and management and administration of drugs. And the Social Welfare Department also steps up their capacity step up their efforts in inspection. In the past 5 years, 103 residential care homes were convicted for non-compliance. Only a handful of cases involved drug management. Starting from April 2024, the subsidy scheme or the training subsidy scheme for staff of residential care homes was extended for 3 years for staff members of residential care homes to be trained on knowledge of drugs. 521 in-service health workers have enrolled in the Advanced Training for Health Workers course under the subsidy scheme at the end of June 2024. We'll continue to provide support to the RCHE staff to ensure the health of elderly residents. Seven members would like to ask questions. Mr. Andrew Lam, Dr. Mr. Tik Chi Yun, Mr. Chen Pui Leung, Mr. Michael Tian, Ms. Connie Lam, Dr. Tan Yue Hang and Dr. David Lam. I'll give each member 4 minutes. Mr. Andrew Lam. Thank you, Chair. In paragraph 7 of the paper, the INT Fund approved $750 million of grants, subsidizing about 2,000 service units to procure or rent over 21,000 tech products. My question is this: how many eligible service units have not received the grant to procure tech products such as pouch packaging machines? Policy-wise, is anything being done to encourage these service units to procure the relevant products and machines and systems? Paragraph 8 and 9 refers to a visiting medical practitioner service as well as adopting a community pharmacy program. I support all the initiatives. I know that there are elderly singletons who demand these services. So I want to know whether the visiting medical practitioner service and the community pharmacy program will cover elderly singletons in the community as well. Well, thank you. For the drug dispensing machines, not many service units have procured the product, I must say, because most of these care homes procure drug management system instead, as we discussed in the previous item. In terms of the drug management system, the technology is more mature, and the major elderly care organizations have procured such a system. In other words, after dispensing medication to an elderly, the system will indicate so. And then I understand that for the machines, they are procured by some of the care homes managed by the Tonghua groups of hospitals. Now, it is quite tricky because even for the same type of medicine, there may be different batches, which may affect how the machines operate. Anyhow, we will encourage more such units to procure the pouch packaging machines. As for the community pharmacy program, we don't have information at hand. We will let members know later. Ms. Kwan can take the other question. Yes, in relation to the INT fund, there are some 50 organizations benefiting from it, including subvented and private homes. They either procure or rent tech products. That's all from me. Chairman, if I may, are they saying that there are more service units which have procured products than those which have not? My question was, the number of service units not applying for funds under the INT fund, and the reason why. Last year, we expanded the INT fund's scope to all licensed homes instead of just subvented homes. The expansion took place in September 2020. So we're talking about subvented and subsidized homes. As for private homes, it's up to them to decide whether to apply depending on their staffing requirements and the size of operation. Usually, the private homes are smaller, the people are older. Well, after the legislative amendments, they will be required to follow the latest guidelines, and they might be using gerontechnology to enhance the efficiency of their operations as well. Dr. Tu Chi-yun. Drug management mishaps in care homes have been a common scene in over the years. According to the Undersecretary, 8 such cases were recorded. I hope this is true, because as I understand in my experience, drug management in residential care homes is really a major problem. Now, we have imported labor, imported care workers, aging care workers, and the absence of pharmacists at all times in residential care homes. All of these make drug management a tricky problem. In the past years, many NGOs have developed their own drug dispensing machines or systems, but they haven't worked as expected, because it's all about whether we have dedicated professionals overseeing the drug dispensing process. We don't have pharmacists on duty in residential care homes to check the prescription of every elderly and whether these prescriptions need to change. The other point is very often we need, well, drug dispensing is a manual process. An elderly person may have a prescription of 6 or 7 tablets and pills, eye drops, etc. Now, the next question is manpower. There is a lack of manpower, and that there may be, and something may go wrong if one gets tired out by the process. Now, in fact, not all mishaps are recorded. We don't know the actual number. For some of these factors, they cannot be solved in the short term, such as lack of manpower. The government should be innovative. I know that there are two or three ongoing projects on drug dispensing systems, so that all the steps that I mentioned, from monitoring, dispensing, packaging, dispatching, all these processes can be automated. One major organization may run 10 homes, they may accommodate several thousand elderly residents, but it's still not large enough in scale to develop this system. We should conduct trials, because otherwise, Under Secretary, you haven't been able to resolve this problem for over a decade. You can't just rely on manual labor. You can't ask these homes to apply for grants under the INT fund and then leave them to their own devices. You should develop a system that is accurate and professional for use by these homes.
Under Secretary, I have to clarify one point. Under the labor importation scheme, we are only allowing the importation of healthcare workers. For those that help manage drugs or medication, they are care workers. So very few people can actually come into contact with the drugs. 8 incidents were recorded, and that's the official figure. If you insist that there are actually lots of cases that have not been reported, well, we can't help. But the figure we have is 8 cases. There are different drug management systems that is helping to improve the situation. Let me ask the assistant director to tell you more. For non-compliance cases, well, there aren't just non-compliance cases that are convicted through inspection and through the complaints we got. We also uncover cases. You said that there were only 8 cases. I hope that this is the truth. I understand that only health workers can help deal with the drugs. However, it's been hard to hire health workers and nurses nowadays. They may only stay in a care home for 2 to 3 weeks and then they resign. Do you know how many elderly people or tenants that one health worker has to take care of a day? Please don't expect residential care homes can, through gerontechnology, solve all the problems. Administration, please take note of this comment. Mr. Chen Puilan. Gerontechnology develops rapidly. There are new drugs and new products that we see regularly. So it's crucial that we train up residential care home staff. According to the paper, there is this training subsidy scheme for staff of residential care homes, and it is going to be extended for 3 years. How do you gauge the effectiveness of the training subsidy scheme? Based on what did you decide to extend this scheme for 3 years? Was it because the scheme was previously successful? You subsidize health workers to enroll in courses recognized by the qualifications framework. After completing the courses, will these health workers be able to, for instance, earn more income or see further promotion in their career, you need to give incentives for residential care home staff to join the programs or courses. As mentioned, gerontechnology develops rapidly. Apart from qualifications framework recognized home, will you offer courses and programs annually? To enhance the knowledge of residential care home staff so that they can better take care of their elderly tenants. Undersecretary, on career promotion or development, under the SWD, we've commissioned a committee to review the manpower structure within the elderly care service industry. Previously, there were only health workers, care workers, and nurses. We're exploring whether it's possible to have another tier of workers between nurses and care workers. This is because we have a huge demand of nurses. This committee that I mentioned will complete the review within this year, and we will report to this panel about the result or findings of the committee. As for whether health workers can see advancement in their career after completing the relevant programs and courses, we will review this through the committee as well. Assistant Director, how can we encourage more health workers to join courses under the training subsidy scheme? Well, we fully subsidize the tuition fees of these training courses for health workers. As they are completing the courses, we also offer subsidies for the residential care homes that the health workers work for so that the operation of the care homes will not be affected because their staff went to the courses. Members asked how we review the subsidy scheme. We looked at how many courses were run, and we also interviewed residential care home operators to assess the effectiveness of the training subsidy scheme. This scheme began in 2019 during COVID. Not a lot of residential care home staff were able to take part of the scheme because of COVID. So we want to extend the scheme for another 3 years so that more health workers can benefit from the scheme. Mr. Michael Tian. Elderly tenants of residential care homes have to take a lot of drugs every day. So it is crucial that we ensure that there aren't mistakes made by workers as they dispense drugs at residential care homes. Health workers, before they are registered, they have to complete a course. They have to learn about different types of drugs, including the English names of the drugs during the course, to ensure that they do not give the wrong medicine to the elderly tenants. These health workers need common sense as they dispense drugs. I mentioned this because there was recently an incident in which a health worker made mistakes in dispensing drugs, and the elderly tenant concerned suffered, therefore. Only 500 health workers benefited from the training subsidy scheme over a period of 5 years. We cannot ensure that health workers who completed the courses were able to do their job in dispensing drugs, right? So it is questionable whether the training subsidy scheme is actually effective. Can you require certain portion of health workers from each residential care homes to take these training courses? That is, you make the training courses compulsory. If they do not complete the compulsory courses, they will not be allowed to dispense drugs. You have to allow time for health workers to complete these courses, of course. If the residential care home operators come back to you telling you that they are short of manpower because all the health workers have gone to the courses, well, you have to take care of this. Say there are 10 health workers in the residential care homes and you request that at least 4 of them complete the training courses. If a health worker makes mistakes in dispensing drugs even after completing the health workers, you'll have to look into the problem. Health workers may be happy because they're able to take the courses that are subsidized by the government. What I'm saying is that you cannot ensure that there won't be any mistakes made by health workers in dispensing drugs even after they've completed the courses. The recent incident that I mentioned, I don't know whether it concerns a health worker who has completed the course or not. Undersecretary, our ultimate goal is that we want nurses to be on duty at residential care homes. For elderly care homes with over 60 tenants, after the transitional period, there should be nurses in these residential care homes after the passage of the bill last year. Currently, we allow both nurses and health workers to work at residential care homes. We encourage health workers to pursue further studies and enhance their knowledge, of course, but we won't ask health workers to be responsible for this. So ultimately, we would hope to have nurses stationing at residential care homes with a certain number of elderly tenants to help with drug dispensing. Is it that you expect there would be mistakes made by health workers in drug dispensing? Are you allowing those who aren't nurses to dispense drugs at residential care homes? Are you telling me that you cannot blame the health workers if they make any mistakes even after they have completed the courses because they aren't professional as nurses? Residential care home staff dispense drugs based on doctors' prescriptions. We don't expect health workers to... Well, let me finish. We do not expect health workers to exceed their responsibilities. We expect them to only dispense drugs according to doctors' prescriptions. We need nurses to identify any potential mistakes, therefore. After the passage of the bill, we expect residential care homes with over 60 elderly tenants to have nurses, therefore. With more manpower, it might improve the situation.
Just to clarify, Chairman, in other words, apart from nurses, health workers who have undergone training under this program will be able to correctly dispense drugs for the elderly. As for doctors' blunders, there is no way that health workers can spot these errors, and that you're confident that as far as health workers are concerned, they will not have any drug dispensing mishaps. Well, of course, after going through training, health workers should be able to transcribe and dispense drugs correctly. If something still goes wrong in the process, we have a penalty system. After investigating the incident, if indeed it's confirmed to be the fault of the health workers, we will issue warning letters, and if and in the more serious cases, the registration of the health worker may be revoked, and this indeed happened before. So let me reassure members that we're going to look into this suggestion as to providing incentive for more health workers to take this training. Ms. Connie Lam, I have two questions regarding drug management of residential care homes for the elderly. In the past 5 years, on average, some 5,600 inspections were conducted. 549 cases were prosecuted, 103 homes were convicted. Only a handful of cases involve drug management. What is meant by a handful? What is the trend? Is it going up or down? Because there are common problems with drug management and dispensing drugs. Now, as for warning and advisory letters issued to RCHEs, some 2,300 advisory letters were issued, and some 113 warning letters were issued to RCHEs. Is there a mechanism to follow up on these homes and see whether the situation has improved? Because in terms of prosecution figures, in the past few years, the figure has not come down. Will anything be done to address the situation by, say, stepping up inspection? Because drug dispensing errors are something that could lead to major consequences. Now, as for the community pharmacy program, it is said that large pharmacies could be set up for care homes. Now, for community pharmacy program, will a consultation be conducted? Can you enlighten the public whether this program will benefit the general public? Honorable Secretary, only a small number of cases involve drug management, and by small number, I'm saying 8 cases. And we just reached the double-digit figure. We received more complaints at the early onset of COVID pandemic. This is perhaps due to an acute shortage of manpower at the time when COVID started. There were social distancing requirements, etc. So that accounts for more cases received. And in fact, in the past few years, the numbers have more or less stayed the same. I'll give the floor to my colleague. About prosecution figures, of the 113 convictions, 8 related to drug management. 35 of the 549 warnings related to drug management, and that's about 5% of the total. Well, I thank the member for the suggestion. She asked whether we could step up inspection. Apart from frequency, we should also devise a targeted approach when inspecting homes. especially when medication presents a very important aspect of residential care home services. And that means we're going to inspect the premises more frequently until we see improvement. Now, about the relatively high number of cases, is exactly because we conducted inspections and the situation improved afterwards, that no further prosecutions were necessary. Community pharmacy program, can you give us an update, Chairman? Well, we will talk to the Health Bureau. We don't have anything to add at the moment. Dr. David Lam. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I just prepared a prescription for somebody suffering from high blood pressure, coronary disease, joint problems, constipation, diabetes. Now, my prescription contains 13 medication. And I think for a normal prescription dispensed to such an elderly resident, it will go from 9 to 14 drugs. 7 of these drugs will have to be taken in the morning, 2 in the evening, and then twice a day for 3 of these medications, and also for 1 type of drug, 4 times a day. In a residential care home, the elderly resident may be ignorant about it, but it's for the care staff to make sure that correct drugs are dispensed. The same goes for RCHD. Drug administration is a major component of primary care. According to the current practice, residential care home residents will be taken to see the doctor, and then drugs will be dispensed. They could go, they'll be good for 6 months, and then they'll be put away for a long time. And then eventually you find out that the medication or the dosage may be wrong. In fact, I made this suggestion to the Health Bureau and your Bureau. Years ago, I asked the government to stop dispensing drugs at the residential care homes. After consulting a doctor, the prescription can go directly to a community pharmacy. The community pharmacy will pack all the necessary drugs in the prescription to the elderly resident on a biweekly basis. This is in fact the system adopted by the hospital authority at the moment. The drugs are packed already, and then you can just scan the codes, and then you can reduce medication errors. You don't need care home staff to dispense drugs manually. And there won't be any error because the drugs will be stored at the pharmacies. And when there's a change of prescription, you can adjust the drugs to be dispensed. At most, you'll be wasting 2 weeks' dosage. In fact, this method is already adopted by Australia. It's not something new. I just hope that the government will consider allowing community pharmacies to play a role in the process. And thank you, Dr. Lam, for your suggestions. We'll talk to the Health Bureau on optimizing the use of drugs and improving the accuracy of drug dispensary for elderly residents. Yes, we will talk to the Health Bureau. I have a short question. You mentioned 8 cases. Is there information? Can you tell us whether the cases involved homes under the enhanced spot play scheme or subsidized homes? Now, basically, these 8 cases of drug dispensing errors involve private homes. Licensed homes? Yes. Right. Just to enlighten me, you have a reporting mechanism, is that right? But is it fair to say that if the case is not reported, there is no way we can find out, right? Right, but according to the code of practice, these homes are required to report such incidents. It will be a breach of the code of practice otherwise. Dr. David Lam pointed out something really practical, because even for doctors, a prescription could be very complex. Drugs will have to be taken at different times, according to different dosages, etc. Perhaps the government could consider imposing a cross-check mechanism. The prescription is tailor-made for each elderly resident, so I imagine the drug dispensing process could be quite complex. Like Dr. David Lam said, we could make use of the community pharmacies, and that all the drugs can be packed in advance. But meanwhile, perhaps you could talk to the homes and revise the code of practice to reduce errors. If there is nothing else, we move on to the next item, any other business. The Society for the Protection of Children invited the panel to visit the Children's Residential Care Home, or CRH, and the panel visited this place on the 28th of September 2022. And now the same society has invited the panel members to visit the CRH again to understand the latest situation after the overhaul. Tentatively, we're going to visit the CRH on the 19th of November in the morning, Tuesday. Right, any views? Should we invite other non-panel members to go on the visit? Yes, if there is no objection, we're going to send out the invitation to all members. If there's nothing else, the meeting's adjourned.